director of the Stratford Festival. And this is a forum event. It's one of 200 events that we hold during the course of the season, which make connections between the plays on our stages today. And I'd like to just take a moment and tell you why I invited Dennis to speak to us today. In putting together the season, I centered around the idea, the theme of after the victory. What happens after we think we've won? And this notion came to me as I reflected on the events after 9/11, the war in Afghanistan, the war that then happened in Iraq, and the fact that they never seemed to end. Even though there were photo ops on aircraft carriers that said mission accomplished, I know that most of us didn't really have clarity on the mission, but I think we all understood that nothing had quite been accomplished. And so it dragged on, and I reflected on how the geopolitical reasons for many of these conflicts, religious and sectarian, go back to the First World War, a war we thought we won. Here we are 100 years later, and then the Second World War. And of course, war breeds horrible events, catastrophic events, not just for those people who are fighting. And remember, the cost, it seems, is almost higher when those soldiers come home than on the battlefield. But for families, for women, for children, for migrants that are caused afterward, there is a toxin that is released into the world that somehow over time needs to somehow be absorbed and changed. And in the plays of the season, Macbeth, for instance, in the first scene, the witches talk about when the battle is lost and won. The duality is there right from the beginning. Fear is mentioned 3 times more often in that play than any other play of Shakespeare. Blood is mentioned more often. And the plays are all informed by this idea of after the victory. But the fear, the recrimination, the anger that is bred in conflict is something that we all live with constantly. It was all my sons that made me think of Dennis. In that play, which was written right after the Second World War, there's a character we never see. Steve Deaver is the partner in the firm who is blamed for shipping, deliberately shipping, cracked aircraft engine head cylinders that are damaged. And he ships them off because he's afraid not to. He ships them off, we don't know why, but he's blamed for it. As the play progresses, we find out the truth. But the man is blamed for it to the degree that even his children won't talk to him. He's a pariah. He's an outcast. In those stressful, tense, angry situations where there is, seems, moral certainty, where there's more hard feelings than there is real knowledge or understanding, who defends the outcast? In today's world of social media, where information comes quickly and understanding takes a lot more time, this is even more accelerated. We are all lucky that there are people like Dennis Edney available and interested in defending us. Dennis has won many awards, much recognition, justly earned, for his work pro bono, for his work defending people in difficult situations, and for his work on human rights. He lectures frequently on the rule of law. You will know him, of course, because of his tireless work, his compassionate work on behalf of the child soldier, Omar Khadr. It's significant that he didn't simply wait for the call. He cold called that family to ask them if they needed help. Dennis will come out. He will speak to us of his experiences, of the rule of law. We then are fortunate to have Paul Kennedy from CBC Ideas here, and Paul will be then interviewing Dennis, and then we'll open up for questions. I think that's it. Except for one important thing, I'm going to ask you to join me in welcoming to the Stratford Festival, Dennis Edney.
So now I know why I was invited here. I thought it was for my high school poetry. I thank you all for inviting me here today. The title of my talk is The Rule of Law in an Age of Fear. I will touch upon a number of themes, and hopefully by the end of my talk, I will have challenged you to question whether the concept and the practice of justice is being carried out in your name. It is an accepted fact that the world today faces grave challenges to the rule of law and to human rights. Previously well-established and accepted legal principles are now being called into question in all regions of the world through what I would suggest, respectfully, are ill-conceived responses to terrorism. Many of the achievements in the legal protection of human rights are under attack. Since September 2001, many countries have adopted new counter-terrorism measures that are in breach, I would suggest, of their international obligations. In fact, in some countries, the post-9/11 climate of fear and insecurity has been exploited to justify long-standing violations of human rights, all carried out in the name of national security. And this has led to an intense debate over where the balance lies between the rule of law, human rights, civil liberties on the one hand, and security on the other. Former U.S. Secretary of State Madeleine Albright, on leaving office in 2001, described her view of what she felt was an appropriate balance. And she stated, and I quote, "We have found through experience around the world that the best way to defeat terrorist threats is to increase law enforcement capabilities while at the same time promoting democracy and human rights." Now, these remarks made pre-9/11 would have resonated with most Western liberal audiences as a mainstream belief, consistent with the rule of law and reflective of values which we prided ourselves on at that time. However, over the years, many Western democracies since 9/11 have reappraised the balance described by Madeleine Albright and exploited the public's insecurity by using fear as a political driver to invade Middle Eastern countries, to erode civil liberties, and to avoid judicial oversight. And that's all been done in the name of national security. Just take, for example, the recently completed British government inquiry into the invasion of Iraq. The Chilcot inquiry took 7 long years to be completed, but it eventually confirmed what many already knew, that lies, misrepresentations, and flawed intelligence was used to justify the invasion of Iraq. Uncontroverted evidence from Dr. Hans Blix, the Swedish diplomat who led the Iraqi weapons inspection team in 2003, carried out 700 inspections at 300 sites and found no weapons of mass destruction, and that Saddam Hussein posed no threat to the West. His findings were simply ignored by Western government leaders and officials who just simply chose to look the other way. forgive me. Under the pretext of national security, Iraq was destroyed, its army and its police force disbanded, and any semblance of a civil society was destroyed. The 2003 Iraq invasion, paradoxically, instead of removing threats, let loose a vicious sectarian civil war that has spread throughout the Middle East, which now, 13 years later, shows no sign of abating. And ironically, this all arose from the appointment of Paul Bremner as governor of the state of Iraq, appointed by George Bush. He had no Middle East experience or understanding of Middle East politics. He had never visited the Middle East or even spoke Arabic. Yet, within a month of his arrival, he declared that he was the law. And then he passed a law that banned approximately 400,000 Ba'athist soldiers and military personnel of Saddam Hussein's army from public sector employment and from access to drawing their military pensions. And as a result of this monumental, consequential decision, Middle East analysts and experts believe that both ISIS and Al-Qaeda leadership is dominated by senior members of Hassan's Ba'athist army. And similarly, in 1967, Gaddafi inherited one of the poorest nations in Africa and turned it into one of Africa's wealthiest nations. Yet after NATO's intervention in 2011, led by France and Britain, Libya is now a failed state and its economy is in shambles. The fall of Gaddafi's administration has created all the worst scenarios. Western embassies have all left. The country has become a haven for terrorists, with rival governments and hundreds of militias fighting for the spoils. Meanwhile, ISIL has gained a foothold in Libya. Just very recently, a United Kingdom parliamentary report recently stated, and I quote, "It saw no evidence that the UK government carried out a proper analysis of the nature of the rebellion in Libya. The UK strategy was founded on erroneous assumptions and an incomplete understanding of the evidence." Simply, the subtext is that no lesson was learned from the Iraq invasion. And with respect, I suggest a problem is that we have allowed governments to engage in national security policies without any proper oversight or transparency, while governments have long shunned civil liberties as a partner in national security policies. We only have to consider the following comments of Tony Blair on the point of leaving office. And he said, "It is a dangerous misjudgment to put civil liberties first. To do so was both misguided and wrong." Or the Bush administration warning Americans that, and I quote, "Our strength as a nation will continue to be challenged by those who employ the strategy of the weak by using international media and judicial processes." Or in Canada, in responding to the Parliament Hill attack, Stephen Harper passed into law Bill C-51, the 2005 anti-terrorism legislation, giving unprecedented powers to our intelligence agency, ceases, and on the basis, and I quote, that the judiciary has been constraining CSIS's powers in the name of preserving civil liberties. Placing the blame on the judiciary is certainly not a novel approach. It is all very well giving tools to counter-terrorism activity, but we need to ensure that those legal tools do not undermine those values that are fundamental to our democratic society. Liberty, the rule of law, and the principles of fundamental justice. Values that lie at the heart of the Canadian constitutional order and international instruments that Canada has signed. And to those who would subordinate human rights to national security, you know, they could have benefited from the words of former Supreme Court Justice William Brennan, because he said, there is considerably less to be proud about and a good deal to be embarrassed about when one reflects on the shabby treatment civil liberties have received in the United States during times of war and perceived threats to national security. After each perceived security crisis ended, the United States has remorsefully realized the abrogation of civil liberties was unnecessary, but it has proven unable to prevent itself from repeating the error when the next crisis comes along. And I much prefer the view attributed to Benjamin Franklin, who said that he who would put security before liberty deserves neither. And these words of Justice Brennan are prophetic when we consider that we have spent much of the last decade and a half witnessing the excess of state power that followed 9/11, from the roundup of Muslims, mass surveillance and religious profiling, to Guantanamo, drones, and torture. And the overuse of words such as terrorists and terrorist threats that frightens people. The phrase war on terror has no more legal or practical meaning than would a war on cancer or a war on poverty. In fact, the United Nations itself has struggled for years to come up with a widely accepted definition of terrorist activity. But meanwhile, the phrase war on terror and the word terrorist has now become synonymous with Islam and Muslims. We've all bought into the phrase war on terror. It is an inaccurate term, a rhetorical device, a cynical manipulation of the public's horror after 9/11. And as a result, public anxiety has increased, along with intolerance, discrimination, and bigotry. Now, misinformed and fueled by fear, it is not a difficult step for people to accept that drastic measures must be taken in the interest of national security. You know, even if it means the suspension of civil liberties or compromising our values or ignoring the rule of law, we all rationalize, you know, it's for the greater good of society. It's for our security. And currently, south of the border, Donald Trump has trampled the boundaries of acceptable politics, core American values, and simply basic human decency. And he has used divisive language and trafficked in conspiracy theories about Muslims and Latinos simply as a means to power. And we're not exempt here in Canada. The racial and religious harmony we as Canadians once prided ourselves on is more tenuous today. It was not helped with former Prime Minister Harper running an election campaign of such cruel mendacity against our own Muslim minority. The attacks included references to barbaric cultural practices, jihadi threat, and the endless hullabaloo over the niqab. These political strategies were deliberate and contrived and were intended to exploit the baser side of our nature, the racist that lies or lurks in all of us. It is my view, for what that's worth, is that we are in troubled times. We are now observing much of the world increasingly responding with xenophobia and racial intolerance. The political temperature this year has been dominated by populists such as Trump and European nationalists who wish to tighten borders and restrict the flow of refugees from war-torn countries, especially Muslims, despite the fact that 86% of refugees, 86%, are still hosted by poor and developing countries near war zones or conflict sites. And more than half of those refugees are children. The current refugee crisis today is one of the gravest humanitarian crises to unfold across the world in modern times. Yet it's also controversial. We must understand that restricting refugees to poor and developing countries, especially when more than half of the refugees are children, is nothing more than xenophobia and intolerance. Instead of understanding our roles as defenders of human rights, of the rights of children, of desperate starving refugees, religious minorities, and so on, we stand by so passively as many lives are lost needlessly. And was it always that we lacked such commitment and compassion as members of the human family? In exchange for false promises of security and exaggerated fears of terrorism, we have allowed evil places such as Guantanamo Bay to exist without criticism. Canada is the only Western country that has never criticized Guantanamo Bay or tolerate the misuse of killing drones in faraway places or without any legal authority for doing so, and much, much more. And on the legal front, we are witnesses to disturbing contemporary events, with habeas corpus being abandoned. I fought for the habeas corpus rights of all detainees in Guantanamo in 2004 before the U.S. Supreme Court, along with others. And we were successful. And it wasn't long before George Bush passed legislation that completely weakened that judgment. Or secret courts being created to hear secret evidence. I've spent so many years in and out of those courts. And guilt being inferred just simply by association. Torture and rendition nakedly justified. And vital international conventions consolidated in the aftermath of the Second World War, the Geneva Conventions, the Refugee Conventions, the Torture Conventions, and many, many more have all been deliberately avoided or ignored in the War on Terror. And every one of those instruments such as the Torture Convention and the Geneva Convention and more, all applied to Omar Khadr, and he never had the benefit of it. And I say to you that future historians will look at this period of instability, beginning with the September 11 attacks on the US and the subsequent launching of the global war on terror with its unrestrained, lawless policies carried out in the name of our national security. We only have to consider Guantanamo Bay to understand how easy it is to fall into lawlessness when we abrogate our responsibility in each and one of us to uphold the rule of law. Guantanamo has been called everything from an offshore concentration camp to a legal black hole. It is a complex of brutal prisons where approximately 1,000 Muslims, men, and a child from all over the world have been held since 2002 by the United States government under incredibly inhuman conditions and in incessant interrogations, all without any judicial oversight or access to a properly constitutional legal system. Yet it was Prime Minister Harper who said on the television prior to the so-called trial that Omar was in that he was facing due process in Guantanamo. There is not such a word such as deep due process in that torture chamber. It is a place without rules and bereft of any justice or any humanity. And these descriptors should come as no surprise to anybody here today. It was in January of 2002 that we all witnessed the first shocking images of detainees hooded and shackled for transportation across the Atlantic to Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, much as other human beings had been carried in slave ships 400 years earlier. And on their arrival in Guantanamo Bay, we witnessed on the television, CNN, the humiliation of these anonymous human beings and loaded on the tarmac like so much human baggage to then be transported to open-air wire cages that would be their home for many years, all without access to family, friends, lawyers, human rights organizations, or any semblance of judicial oversight. And the media photos of detainees, you recall, in orange jumpsuits, crouched in open cages, cuffed, hooded, and masked, while kneeling at the feet of US soldiers, became symbolic of how the United States intended to fight its war on terror, followed by its feckless partners, such as Canada. And for the watching world, no knowledge of international humanitarian conventions was needed to understand that what we were witnessing was simply unlawful. This was not a manifestation of the Geneva Conventions at work, nor was it an act of deportation or extradition. It was far, far worse. It was the unlawful transportation to a world outside the reach of law and intended to remain so. And in that world, crimes against humanity were to be carried out. You know, it was 5 years on when President Obama, in his 2007 presidential campaign, spoke about closing Guantanamo with passion. I recall that because I was flying out of Washington, D.C. on the day of his inaugural and flying into Guantanamo. And he raised the hopes of those solitary, lonely, abandoned individuals, not only in the cages of Guantanamo, but also in the secret prisons of Guantanamo that your media never, ever mentions. And he said it with passion, at least I thought he did, in the dark halls of Abu Ghraib and the detention cells of Guantanamo, we have compromised our values. Well, Guantanamo, since then and continuing, has been the scene of dubious, lengthy detainments, force feedings, sleep deprivation, stress positions, vicious beatings, and other and many other forms of torture. And amongst them, for 10 years, from the age of 15, was a boy, a Canadian boy, Omar Khadr, abandoned by all of us, but particularly by our government. Meanwhile, Canadian officials of all stripes, including former Affairs Minister Bill Graham and Peter McKay, persisted in telling the Canadian public that they had been assured Omar was being treated humanely and would take the United States at their word. Despite the fact that human rights organizations such as the Red Cross, Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, and so on, were reporting as early as 2003 and 2004 that systemic sexual and physical abuse and murder was standard procedure in Guantanamo Bay. Yet every other Western country was less accepting of the United States and demanded and were granted the return of their citizens in Guantanamo Bay, adults, each and every one of them. But no one came for Omar Khadr. The reality was that the Liberal government of the time was simply misleading the Canadian public. In partnership with the Bush administration, Canadian officials, along with the CIA, would regularly interrogate Omar in Guantanamo. And 3 weeks prior to the Canadian visit, it was arranged that Omar would be sleep deprived by having him move from cell to cell to cell each and every 3 hours up to 21 days. The Israeli Supreme Court has ruled that sleep deprivation is one of the most effective torture techniques that one can use, and it causes mental illness. Damien Corsetti is a chap that I've been dealing with over the years. He's a torturer. He's one of Omar's torturers. And you can see him being interviewed in CBC. And he talks about the sleep deprivation. He said, you know, it works. It really works. These guys are walking into a wall or speaking to mythical figures. And it's then that we take them into the room and we interrogate them. Think about that. If you were asked in that condition, did you shoot John F. Kennedy, what would your answer be? Of course. And this took place, these abuses by our own government, 3 years into Omar Khadr's detention. And for the first 3 years, he'd never been charged with an offense or access to a court or to a lawyer, to a visit from family, which never ever happened, or a consular visit. Consular Relations Act was not allowed, was not accepted in that no-law zone called Guantanamo Bay. And it's in those conditions that I met him. I remember the first day I saw Omar Khadr. I thought I was going to the cages. I was kind of excited. My ego was engaged. I was one of the very few lawyers getting into Guantanamo, and I'd fought for 3 years to do so. And then I was taken away from the cages, and I was put into a boat with about 12 soldiers making sure that I'm protected. And then there are 3 secret prisons in Guantanamo, concrete edifices in the desert. And it was one of those that I saw Omar Khadr. He has spent most of his life in solitary confinement. And I walked into this deadly silent building. I walked into this cell. It had no windows. It was freezing. And I don't mean cold. I mean freezing. Because that is a technique to make sure you never rest well. And sitting on the edge of a bed without blankets was a young boy chained to a floor, looking like a broken sparrow. And when I used to talk about that, I used to get upset. And I remember just gasping. I didn't know where I wanted to cry. I didn't know where I wanted to run. I didn't know what I wanted to do. I couldn't believe that I'd be witnessing this. And I'd arrived there as a tough, experienced lawyer, and I left there as a pretty sad father. And over the next 7 years, Omar continued to suffer the anguish of the damned. And even when the UN Secretary General's Special Representative for Children in Armed Conflict stated publicly that Omar's trial in Guantanamo violated international legal norms, our country ignored it. Or when the chief director of UNICEF expressed, and I quote, "Anyone prosecuted for offenses allegedly committed as a child should be treated in accordance with international juvenile standards, providing special protections. Omar Khadr should not be prosecuted by a tribunal that is neither equipped and meet these protections and meet these standards." Absolutely clear that he was going into a lawless court, and yet our Canadian government remained silent. And it continued to remain silent, even though Romeo Dallaire described the stance of the Canadian government with regards to Omar Khadr as a black mark on Canada's international reputation and standing in the fight for child's rights and human rights as a whole. And the Canadian government has remained silent to this present day. Surely, I say to you, there can be no greater rebuke against a government that purports to uphold the rule of law than to have been complicit in something that is not only illegal, but is real and horrifying against one of its citizens, the torture of a Canadian youth. It goes against everything that we stand for, everything. The respect for human dignity. I will digress for a moment. In anticipation of Omar coming to live in my home, I had contacted some of the former Guantanamo detainees living in London, three of whom have become human rights advocates. And one of them said to me, you know, Dennis, I'll share this with you because I trust you. He said, but you know, first of all, you have to understand that we were only in Guantanamo for 4 years. Omar was in Guantanamo for 10. And he said, the most overwhelming mistreatment was sexual abuse. And I realized in that conversation that all those detainees that I've been in touch with over the years, they carry that hidden secret, the sexual abuse that they would take. And he described some to me, which I wouldn't describe to you, but I would say to you that if you think of some vicious, pornographic activity, double it. And he said, you know, Dennis, when I put my kids to bed at nighttime, there are times I just can't sleep. And I get in my car, I drive up the motorway, and I go screaming into the night. And there's another detainee, British detainee, he's a big bruiser. And I like meeting him because he always grabs me and gives me great hugs. But what he says is, you know, I can't talk well because my nose is smashed right into my nose by a guard. And you know, I can't see out of this eye because a guard stuck his finger right through my eyes. And he's now a lawyer in London. So let me then, as I come to the end of my talk, fast forward to the present day. Omar has been on bail for the past year and a half, pending a long-awaited hearing before the military commission. I appealed that his case 6 months after he was found guilty in this incredible trial where not one single witness was called on his behalf except a teacher that I had retained to send some educational courses. Meanwhile, the torturers were able to come on the stand and tell in a Kafka type of aspect about what he said to them while torturing them. In fact, Joshua Claus, the chief torturer of Omar Khadr, he said that he had, when Omar was in hospital, he said, and he acknowledged before the judge, who was very deferential to Joshua, he said, well, you know, I interrogated him 20 to 25 times, up to 6 hours at a time. And then I think to irritate me because we didn't like each other for some reason. He said, you know, I may have been a bit rougher with Omar Khadr than with others. And that was a significant comment because Claus, and you could check it out in Google, Joshua Claus was convicted of killing one detainee and crippling two others using the exact same techniques that he used on Omar Khadr. And our government sat there with its representatives watching this so-called trial. And I remember saying to a official that I had never felt so embarrassed about myself until I participated in that sham trial called in Guantanamo. And Omar is living with us and my wife and our children. And he has set out to improve his life and not to look back in anger at his mistreatment. He has not an angry word for anybody. And he never had an angry word in Guantanamo either. I found it stunning to observe that. And he has recently obtained his driver's license, his high school diploma, and has taken courses in the fall. I guess we're in the fall now, to upgrade himself as he wishes to be accepted into a nursing college. And in my journey over the years, I continue to represent him because in a lawsuit against the Canadian government and an attempt to force the Americans to hear his appeal, the journey becomes long, becomes tiring, becomes exhausting. You start to question who your friends are, your family members, the Canadian public. And so I'd lost faith in the Canadian public up and until Omar was released. And I live in this Jewish neighborhood, no disrespect, but it's a very conservative area. And most of my neighbors had never talked to us because you drive into your garages and you close the door and you don't see each other from 1 year to the next. But when he got out, the day he got out, and we had this impromptu press conference, my neighbors were standing out welcoming him to Canada. In fact, some came with flowers and food. But the people of Edmonton restored my belief in the Canadian spirit. Because many people have stopped Omar, and not one has been abusive, and non-intrusive as well, saying, "Hello, you're Omar. welcome. And I remember my first or third day, I think it was, going to a lumber store with Omar. And this big bruiser looks at me in such an aggressive way and he goes by. And I thought, And then he turns around and comes walking past me, walks up to Omar and says, "You're Omar Khadr? I don't like Americans. I don't like how they treat you. You deserve more." And walked away. And so I tell you that story because it's so important for the development and the healing of Omar Khadr to be into a different society that expresses its values so much better, so much fundamentally, than what he had spent 10 years facing. And, you know, I'm not a religious man at all. But recently, Pope Francis, on his visit to Poland, stated that the world is at war, but it is not a war of religions. Religions don't want war. It is the others that want war. It is a war of interests, for money, for resources, and dominion of peoples. And then he went on to say that the world today needs values. So as I conclude, I'd ask you to reflect on the kind of society we wish to pass on to our children. And I say to you that silence isn't an option. Anger, vengeance, and violence are simply exceedingly easy to access and effortlessly unleashed. The higher calling is belief in moral justice and the inevitable victory of justice over wrong. We may not have control of the world events, but we do have control over how we respond to the world. We do have control how we treat each other. So in the end, it is not about policies that work. It is about forging consensus, fighting cynicism, finding the political will to make change, and to find the character to open our hearts to another, all deserving of equal treatment and respect. Courage doesn't always roar. Sometimes it is the little voice at the end of the day that says, "I'll try again tomorrow." Thank you.
I think the first thing I want to say is thank you. It is almost inconceivable to imagine what Omar has been through. It's an ordeal that defies comprehension. But thank you for doing what you've done to bring his story not just to Canadians but to the world, and to seek some form of justice in what is an impossible and ugly situation. So thank you very much. I had heard before your description of your first meeting with Omar, where you describe him as the sparrow, and I find that very powerful. What I want to begin with is something that precedes that. And what was the inspiration for you making the cold call to the Khadr family to say, "Do you need help?"
Well, first of all, I had some time on my hand. I had just finished a 4-year organized crime trial. And it was in between that and doing the Toronto 18 terrorist trial. And I'd been reading about Guantanamo and about a child and other children in Guantanamo. There was about 22, 23 children in Guantanamo at the very outset. And then the Bush administration asked Human Rights Watch if it would repatriate all those children within the first 2-3 years. And the only name on the table wasn't Omar Khadr. And so what I did was I wrote to the... truly, naively, I thought that this is such a humanitarian issue. I'd like to know more about it, and I contacted my government. And I kept writing, and I received no responses. And so what I decided to do was, I'm going to go to court. I'm going to force the government to respond to me. But then I couldn't get Omar's signature because he's in Guantanamo. So I contacted his mother and grandmother and introduced myself. And then they gave me their approval, their written approval. And then I went into court and I started challenging the government for information. I filed a small civil lawsuit, and which I abandoned once I was able to get approval by the court. I then moved into other areas of law. But I haven't answered your question fully. I just thought it was wrong. And maybe my Scottish stubbornness got in the way at the outset. But when I went to Guantanamo, it resonated that I was doing the right thing. And I had never thought that I would be 13 plus years later still doing the same pro bono file. But it truly was, if I had have walked away, and I wanted to walk away a number of times, both financially, not seeing my wife, I missed both my boys' high school graduation by being in Guantanamo. But if I'd walked away, I would have had to lie to myself. I would have to say, someone else will pick up the chalice. You'll be okay. And I also understood that when I was there, he wouldn't be tortured. Interrogations took place. They call it interrogations. They don't call it torture, but it's interrogations. It's incredible. But every 3-4 days, every detainee goes through interrogations. And so I knew that by coming back, I could give him some respite. And so I just couldn't walk away. And I think all of us, there are times in life when you're faced with a challenge and you don't know what you're going to do. I had no idea what I was going to do. But you just can't walk away from it. Otherwise, it's hard to live with yourself.
I guess looking for an almost deeper background or a more personal explanation that goes further back. What made you pick up the phone? I mean, what makes Dennis Edney, somebody who's worried about a kid who was accused of something on the other side of the world and then ends up in Cuba? Why do you find any interest in that?
You know, Paul, I've been asked that many times, and I don't really answer it.
I haven't answered yet, but
because to do that would mean to describe my background. I come from a sectarian background. My mother was a Catholic. My father was a Protestant. My first fight I ever had was 10 years old to protect my mother from being assaulted. So I'm also Scottish, and so we always thought of ourselves as underdogs, and we all have a chip on our shoulder. And so that's the best answer I can give you.
I guess the reason I'm looking for an answer and the reason I'm pushing is that that I'm hoping that there can be some inspiration for other people in what you've done, because what you've done is a both noble, courageous, not self-serving, obviously, just the opposite. It is something that is incredibly generous and crucially generous for the life of that.
Well, I'm a lawyer.
And that's not what we normally assume lawyers do.
We should. I'm a bencher for the Law Society of Alberta. And I'm always saying that if you want to be a businessman, then be a businessman. But if you're a lawyer, then you're dedicated to fighting for justice. And I know many, many great lawyers out there. I know lawyers who have never seen a courtroom or have never even thought about doing anything pro bono. But I think that all of us should be thinking that way, that we are part of this human family, not from Edmonton or from Alberta or from Canada, but from the world. And if we were to stand up and challenge instead of being apathetic, the world would be much better.
I'd like to talk for a while about something that is actually painful for me to hear, not as a person, but as a Canadian. Not that those are necessarily distinct things, but in the middle of your presentation, you described my country as feckless. Not a word I would like to have in any way in the same sentence with Canada. How did we become feckless? How did this country, which prides itself on a human rights tradition, which prides itself on peacekeeping internationally, how did we fall into the position where we were the pariah among the civilized countries, along with the West? We made no criticisms, as you enumerated. We never said anything to object to this horrendous miscarriage of justice.
Well, we really have a bad history of human rights. You know, I think we've become, as the years progressed and the plurality of society, we have become far more neighborly to each other, vastly different than south of the border. It's not for me to say how you got there, but I could tell you that, you know, when the Supreme Court of Canada ruled, I took 5 years of going into court, because I was aware from contacts I'd had in the States that there was a videotape of one of the interrogations of Omar Khadr by his CSIS in the CIA, which is, and so I requested the Americans for that, but they had no idea what I was talking about. And so I challenged Canada. And I obtained this 5 years later, all the way up to the Supreme Court of Canada. I finally get this video that justified everything I was told. And I thought the next day the media would be all over me, that people would be knocking on my door, I'd be getting the Nobel Peace Prize next week. You know, and not a silence. And so it's not for me to tell you what you have to do and why you're doing it. I mean, the day that Omar Khadr, I got him out on bail, I was in the YMCA having a steam and then getting ready to go to court. And a lawyer came up to me, a particular lawyer came up to me and told me that I was a nice guy, but I was foolish, because you can't trust those Muslims. Didn't actually say that, but it was the foolish left the blank after that. I have a great love for Canada. I'm so grateful to be here. But, you know, we've taken, because we are a civil society, I think we take so much for granted. We think that a society couldn't change. Well, I could tell you that, and it's my politics coming out, if Mr. Harper had stayed in for another 3 years, this country really would have changed. And you've seen the change south of the border. Because it is, my point was, when you abrogate your responsibility to ensure that your country follows good values and the rule of law, it's easy to get into a lawlessness. And so we have confused democracy with entitlement. We've got a nice house, a nice car, we've got a job, and everything's okay. It's not, because every day we're now reading about the excesses that's taken place. So we have to wake up. We have to make a part of our every day to challenge, to speak out. We're just maybe too polite. It's the best I can do, Paul.
How can we actually improve that situation or make it possible for Canadians? I mean, there cannot be a more dramatic, more drastic incident or case than Omar Khadr.
Well, you know, I've spoken to thousands of people. I don't do this journey because I want publicity. I've had a lot of publicity. But I understood years ago that if I was going to really be effective, I couldn't just rely upon the courts. I have not lost a single case in the Canadian courts over 13 years on behalf of Omar Khadr, and yet he still remained in Guantanamo. And I needed the Canadian public, I needed you. And so I have spoken everywhere from one little church and somewhere to a little hall, back and forth. And after I talk, and you all tell me I'm great, I don't hear from you. My wife's not going to like this, but my wife is really the saint. Because my wife was the person who fed me the money to continue to fight in four Supreme Court challenges. You know what that costs? So recently, a judge stopped me in Edmonton and asked me, he said, how much money have you received from the bar, the Alberta bar, over the years? And I said, I think two lawyers gave me $200 each. And judges and lawyers, everyone knows who I am. And every so often I get a call from some young girl, some young boy who wants to work under me. But, you know, I can only give you those examples of for people to go home and consider what they should be doing. And similarly with the audience here, I don't know how my talk changes you. I have talked for 13 years. I did 10 years ago, I received a pro bono award from all the law societies of Canada. I got this little glass thing. And my wife gets annoyed when I get these little glass things and I'm not interested. But it was a pro bono award. And so when I spoke to over 200 lawyers in Vancouver, I said to them, you know, first of all, if my grandfather and father thought I was getting a pro bono award, they would be so ashamed of me. And secondly, I said, there's not a word in the Scottish dictionary called pro bono. But I didn't receive a single call or a single email from any of those 200 lawyers. And so we really, and similarly when I do talks, I get very little contact back. I occasionally have some young person who wants to keep in touch and I give them my email. But no, I can only talk about the silence. I don't want to be mean, but that's my reality, my truth.
I think I could safely say there's been a general perception that Canada has changed. And I would actually push that what you've done with Omar Khadr has been part of that change. But what most people would point to would be an election that happened in November of 2015. And that the tone of the country, the sense of the country, many people say we've got Canada back. Is that your assessment?
Well, I'm Scottish, you know. It's doom and gloom. I hope so. That's my belief, because we need a real prime minister. And we all want Justin Trudeau, regardless whether he's a liberal or a conservative, we want a different type of environment, a political environment. But, you know, I hate to tell you my age, but I'm getting up there. And so I'm still fighting with the Canadian government to apologize to Omar Khadr. And, you know, I've spoken to so many politicians over the years, and they just dismiss me. I'm so used to being dismissed. Actually, I think they run as soon as they see me. And, you know, I recently was on some government panel giving advice about law. It shows you how I fooled them. But, you know, I spoke with the Minister of Justice about wishing to sit down with her. I still wait for her to call me. For me, the proof is in the, what is the word?
Pudding.
In the pudding. And so I don't want to hear language. I want to see actual changes. What does it take to apologize? What does it take to compensate Omar Khadr? Nothing. Why is it a silence? And so on. So am I happy that we have a new government? Yes. Do I have the same wishes that we've come back together as a collective of human beings? I hope so. But you have to ask yourself, what have you done? Have you knocked on the door of your politician and asked him at what he's been doing lately? One of these days I'm going to get arrested when I speak to kids. Because when I speak to kids, I say to them, knock on the door of your local politician. He doesn't want to speak to you until it's come the next election. And ask him if he's doing things that you think he should be doing, like human rights. And if he doesn't want to talk to you, then get all your friends and protest outside and then call the press. I said, you've got power. You have power. And I say that to all of us. People tell me that they have no power. We have power. I'm just this little guy. I'm not a Don Cherry, but I use that phrase. I'm just a little guy from Scotland who went to Edmonton because my wife dragged me there. And yet, I could take on governments. And if I could take on governments, what could we all do?
In the context of the question I just asked, could
you... Notice how I answered directly.
Could you imagine this government or any government? A Canadian government is what I'm talking about. Could you imagine the repeal of C-51, the bill that you mentioned in your talk?
Well, you know, Bill C-51, and I don't want to criticize the fact that nothing has been done about Bill C-51 over a year later. The parliamentary committees that were set up to hear Bill C-51 had all kinds of high-profile, highly educated individuals with no political gain criticizing Bill C-51. For me, Bill C-51 is terrible. It's a legislation that will take years to ever understand the extent of it. What we have done is we've created an incredibly powerful intelligence agency called CSIS. And if you want to give resources, then I say you give it to the RCMP. There are your local police. Bill C-51 works against all that I stand for in terms of and due process and rights. And nothing has been, and Trudeau talked about he was going to do something. And now he talks about, well, we're going to have more talks. He doesn't need to hear any more talks. He has to listen to those academics, those former prime ministers who all criticize Bill C-51. We don't need it. We have enough tools in the criminal code.
Can we talk about Omar, not briefly, we could talk about Omar for a long time, but I'm tremendously fascinated by the life experience, the trajectory, the narrative of his life. I mean, as a boy, he was involved in something that is something that's very foreign to me, and I won't go into whatever the motivations were for that, but you tell us today that he's now hoping to go and become, to study to be a nurse. And that strikes me as an unbelievable trajectory. I mean, there's something very life-affirming and hope-giving in what he wants to do. Why does he want to do that? Is there no anger? Is there no...
I saw my role in the early years when I sat in a cell spending so much time speaking to this young man. And all the years I went to Guantanamo, he was always chained to a floor. So I saw my job as trying to keep him alive. And I talked to him about hope. And I used to keep pointing to the steel door, and I said, behind that door is light, and you'll get there someday. Even though I can't say I got to a point where I didn't believe it. But this young man seemed to have, well, first of all, he had his faith. His faith has kept him and many others in Guantanamo alive. A real true faith, a real belief in God. I don't have that. So that has been an important aspect. Is he special? I don't like to say that anybody's special, but I find him to be special. He has no anger, and he has suffered. But in my house, he's wonderful. For example, we have a 15-year-old Omar. And sometimes a younger one than that, and then we have a 29-year-old Omar. And so what Omar likes to do is to go shopping to Costco with my wife. And so Patricia says, isn't that nice? And I said, in front of Omar, he's just manipulating you, Patricia. All he is doing is going with you to Costco so he could drive my Ram Dodge truck. And that's what he's doing, but we can have fun that way. I was in Argentina for a little while, working with the prosecutor down there, dealing with how to put military junta up on trial, and making sure that there were the right witnesses were put on the stand, because torture had been endemic down there. And so I gave a talk one night to all these people, a Nobel Peace Prize winner who had been tortured, and many others. There was over 200 lawyers who just simply disappeared out of Buenos Aires overnight. That was the kind of horror that people faced. But I've yet to meet anybody who's been tortured, who's angry, who wants to get a gun and come after you. What I have noticed, what I think I've noticed, is that people who have been tortured have realized that they've been taken to an incredibly baser level of humanity than we can understand. And they wish to ensure that never happens to anybody else. And the reason I say that is because years ago I said to Omar in a cell, what do you want to do when I get you out of here? And he said, I wish to be a doctor. And I said, why? And he said, because I want to make sure that nobody's ever hurt like I've been hurt. And so... I think it's hard for us to understand how someone becomes even more human out of abject abuse. But that's what happens.
It seems there's almost two instincts he's feeling there. One, to help, to be a doctor or a nurse, to be somebody who's a caregiver. The other, the drive to Costco, seems to look for a normal life, which is very different from the life, the only life he's known, really. That Costco is something like being a kid again, living the childhood that he never had.
I remember, try to be careful here, but I remember realizing in the cells that he had been damaged. He had to have been damaged. Every male figure had abused him, because that's the process. And so not only did I talk about hope, but I would also tease him. I would trash talk him, and he'd trash talk me back. In fact, I realized that he must have learned how to adjust to different torturers so that I don't get too hurt, too damaged. And so I had to build up a trust. And I remember, I've never said this publicly, but I remember one time challenging him to a arm wrestle. And he arm wrestled me, and he beat me. And I let that be because I let the message to sink in that I didn't harm him because he beat me. I was building up trust. You can trust me. And then I remember trash-talking him. And he was getting good at it too, actually. And I remember, and I'd always say things such as silly things like, I can take you any time, Omar. Now, any lawyer hearing this would just be shocked. You know? But I remember one time he responded in the cell saying, in your dreams, Edney. And I went, wow. Yes. I thought, great. And so it's a complex journey.
You were not only his lawyer. You were, in a sense, a father, a surrogate father.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, I have to say I was with a consular official, former consular, defeat chap, and he told me, he asked me if had I ever found any evidence to establish that his father had been involved in terrorism, and I said no, and his comment to me was, and neither did we.
Wow.
And so Afghanistan is a pretty weird place to be. And so, I don't know where I was going with that answer. What was the question?
Well, the observation was that you were a surrogate father for him.
So I found it important to ensure not to take away Omar's family from him, because that's all he had. And so I always supported them. And then as the years progressed, I would point out the concerns I had about certain members of his family who said, you know, made stupid comments in the media, etc. So I slowly let him know that we all come from families, we all hide little secrets about our families and we don't want to share it with the public. And that's normal. And so I often thought that any decent father would want me to act in the way I acted with him. That here I'm going to spend years with this young man trying to get him out. Didn't think it was ever going to happen. And so what could I be? I had to step out of the lawyer. I had to be the human being. And I was the father, but not too far into that fatherhood, because I knew that I had to be in complete control of myself in Guantanamo. And there were many a time where I wanted to just lash out. against gods. You know, I would be left. But I myself have been locked in a cell. I myself have been in a Learjet that's been diverted to some airport or small airbase in Florida when I was supposed to going to Canada, and questioned all day. My government didn't assist me. I didn't know if I was going to get back on a plane. And late at night, I was given the opportunity to make a call, and I called the Toronto Star. And I was out the next day. And I've had guards, and I've met torturers, and I've heard vulgar things, evil things. I've seen evil things. But I knew that the day that I lost my cool was the day that I'd never get back into Guantanamo. So it's all part of that journey.
Who is a hero for you? Who would you look to as a mentor, somebody, a forerunner, somebody who's done what you've done?
My wife. You know, I worry about money. I keep saying Scottish, but I worry about money. I'm a poor boy. My wife protected me from that. Year after year after year after year. My wife never once said you hadn't been home. My wife is the greatest gift that's been given to me.
That's a very powerful answer, because I think in some sense it reflects what you're saying, and that is, yeah, we're all individuals, except none of us is in this alone. And so you have your wife, you have your family, you have sons whose major events in their lives were missed because you were dealing with Omar Khadr. And if you expand that circle, Omar was alone, but you were there for him. And ultimately, you engineered it so that some people began to get interested in what was a horrendously, unspeakably bad situation. And so as the circle expands, the hope expands too. And it is the support that one gets from allies like wives and like ideologically right-thinking people who can...
Well, a good example of that was King's University. King's University is a Christian school that my son went to. It's a university, I should say. And I was always a bit cautious about a Christian school, but my wife wished to put Cameron there. And I was also... And so I turned up there to give a talk to the whole school. And this is a university that 3-4 times a year they have a convocation where they deal with different difficult issues. Homosexuality, natives, Aboriginal rights, etc., etc. And the students have to participate, and they don't have to agree, but they have to participate, and they bring in speakers. And I was a speaker speaking about justice. And this was years ago, and I talked about Omar Khadr. And then I said, which I say to young people, is that we've made a mess of the world. It's in your hands. You should take control. Make it better, because we've made a bad mess. So that school took on Omar Khadr. These young men and young women, they challenged all their professors. They didn't allow them to run away. Look, I'm busy. I got to call, make an appointment to see me. To the point that they then rented the Symphonic Hall in downtown Edmonton to have me talk to Edmontonians. And then, of course, what our kids do, they stand outside protesting. Even though I'm going to be, even though I'm going to
you
be
told
talking,
them to.
They're protesting, you know. And that university then has been integral to Omar's development, because that's where he goes. He has the best teachers helping him to move through the system, the educational system. They offered him a position at that school, even though that university's funding came from groups that were not so encouraging about Omar Khadr. And so with no disregard to someone over 25, I really should be speaking to kids. That's what I like. They'll go out and do it.
Keep speaking to kids and keep speaking to everybody. Thank you so much for everything you've done. And unfortunately, the time is up. The time just flew by, as you can tell. I did manage to get a couple questions from the audience in, but we could have gone on for the entire weekend here, I think, for sure. It is my privilege, actually, to suggest it to a couple more events that you might want to go to in the forum as we begin to wind down the season. Tomorrow, I can tell you that I will be here, actually, not on stage, but in the audience, very much in the audience, watching a performance of The Door You Came In, which is an amazing musical production. David McFarlane, I'm a sort of wannabe Newfoundlander, I think. David McFarlane wrote an amazing book called The Danger Tree, which is a description of something that is very important in Newfoundland, the Battle of Beaumont Hamel, where half of the male population of the island was destroyed in the First World War. Canadians don't really know about it. It happened on July 1st, which is Canada's national holiday. It's actually Remembrance Day in Newfoundland. David wrote an amazing book about it. He's also a musician. He'll be singing songs. There'll be spoken word describing that. That's tomorrow right here. And the other forum event that I can't believe everybody isn't going to. It's something that's been happening because Madam Chief Justice Beverly McLaughlin has been a guest at the forum for several years in a row now, trying important issues. And this year they're trying Macbeth. And it's fascinating. They will be deciding whether Duncan was killed by Macbeth and Lady Macbeth because of their excessive political ambitions. And the star witness at that case where Madam Chief Justice will be there, will be, in fact, Bob Ray. So I would recommend that anyone try to go to that. That will actually be in the Festival Theatre on October 1st from 10 to 11:30. Those are events in the forum. Thank you so much, and please join me again in thanking Dennis Edwards.